Now the other question, very very controversial question, has always been not controversial, but it has also created conflict. Shaivists thinks that Shiva is supreme. Ganapatis thinks that Ganapati is supreme. Vaishnavas think Vishnu is supreme. But all of these people believe in Dashavatara theory. However, Hare Krishna movement, ISKCON, Krishnaites think Krishna is supreme and every other is a demigod or a subordinate. Kind of a, I don't know whether it is intentionally done or not, but I have seen many speakers taking this line, talking about it, and the other sects or other sampradayas take it as very take it as a disrespect, or they get offended. So why
Yes.
nobody is denying that you think that Krishna is supreme, but why to call other deities as subordinates or demigods in your
Okay.
translation or commentary?
Okay, that's a good, very good question. See, I would like to just quickly share the screen here. See, one of the big problems is that we are trying to present wisdom from one tradition in a language that is different from the tradition's original language. So these categories, broadly, when we consider Western religious traditions, they had two categories. There is monotheism and polytheism. So Judaism, Christianity, Islam, they are monotheistic. And before that, they're the Greco-Roman religions, they're polytheistic. So these three religions, they pride themselves that we are monotheistic religions. And those polytheistic people are primitive. Now, when they came to India, when the British colonials came to India, British or European colonialists, they came to India, they looked at the Indian religious system from that perspective. So you people also worship so many gods, therefore you must also be polytheistic. However, the Vedic tradition is much more sophisticated. It doesn't really, the Vedic conception of divinity is too subtle and sophisticated to fit into these Western categories of polytheism and monotheism. Now, why do we saying like that? Because there is a fundamental difference that if you look at the Bhagavad Gita primarily, in the Bhagavad, if you, and then look at the Abrahamic religions, see, they have the idea of one true God and many false gods. And their idea is that the false gods are to be condemned, their idols are to be destroyed, their worship has to be stopped, so that the one true God will be glorified. That is their understanding. However, that is the Abrahamic understanding. The Vedic understanding is very different. The Vedic understanding is there is one God who manifests at multiple levels. And there are multiple levels, and God manifests through different manifestations. And these different manifestations are all cooperating for one mission. And that one mission is to elevate people's consciousness. So there is no concept of false gods the way it is in the Abrahamic tradition. So nobody considers, say, even if a Shaivite will not consider a Vishnu to be a false god,
Correct.
nor will a Vaishnavite consider Shiva to be a false god. Now, we understand that they are also gods, they are also venerable beings. They're very, 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 very respected and venerable beings. Now, as I said, this difference that the Vedic conception, if at all we want to call it, the word would be polymorphic monotheism. That monotheism is one God, one ultimate reality is being worshipped. But that one ultimate reality manifests in many different ways. Morpha is form. So
Correct.
in many different forms, that poly is many. So that one ultimate reality manifests in many different forms. And when that one ultimate reality manifests in many different forms, all those forms are respectable. All those forms, they are parts of a cosmic plan for the elevation of human beings. Now, if you see, the traditional terminology is there is Bhagawan and there are Devatas. So, Bhagawan is the supreme being. And Devatas, there are many Devatas. There is Indra, Chandra, Varuna, Vayu. Mm-hmm. All these are considered devatas. Mm-hmm. So there is some differentiation between the devatas and Bhagawan.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you render these words? Because in the Abrahamic tradition, there's only the word God.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you talk about Bhagawan? There are and devatas in the West, in English.
Mm-hmm.
So there are certain words to be used for that.
Mm-hmm.
And some words may seem disrespectful in certain contexts.
Mm-hmm.
But there is no disrespect intended. Even Swami Prabhupada, he said that the devatas are to be respected.
Mm-hmm.
The devatas are also venerable beings. Their worship is talked about by Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita
mm-hmm.
also.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, there is, let me put another slide over here to illustrate this. So if we consider, where have we gone? Yeah. So, sorry, let me come here itself.
So you're saying the Trinity is our demigods? Or the devatas?
Somehow, I mean, the word demigod suddenly brings a negative connotation.
Mm-hmm.
So let's focus on understanding the concept rather than getting caught in terminology.
Okay.
Hmm? The concept is that there is, okay, is my screen visible now?
Not shared.
Okay, sorry. So if we consider, there is one divine being, that divine being manifests at many different levels. So here, now even the word Trinity is a little simplified word, because in Christianity they have the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Sure, sure.
So that word Trinity they have used.
Mm-hmm.
But in the Vedic tradition is Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. They perform integral functions for the existence of the cosmos. And what are the integral functions? They, at every moment, creation is happening, maintenance is happening, destruction is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Even in our body, cells are being regenerated, destroyed and maintained. So mm-hmm. in that sense, all these three devatas, they are vital for all these three divine beings. They are vital for the existence of the cosmos.
Mm-hmm.
And they all are to be respected. So now, as I said, we follow the Bhagavad Gita. And we can go into the technicality of the Bhagavad Gita. But in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that, yes, he talks about yepya anya devata bhakta. That he talks about those who worship me and those who worship other devatas. So Krishna does differentiate between them. But then he says, those who worship other devatas, the faith to worship them, I give it to them. And if they get the result, it is I who give the result through them. So what Krishna is saying is that there is no competition between us. We are all working together. So the Vedic conception of divinity is a very, very compassionate conception. Now, this is, I would like to illustrate this with one example of a story. Now, oh, not this one. So basically, the idea is that some of us may know about this. In the Judaic tradition, there is the idea of God is a jealous God.
Mm-hmm.
So jealous God means that there is one that you should worship only this God and no other God.
Mm-hmm.
But in the Vedic tradition, the understanding is God is not jealous. He is zealous. Zealous means he's eager for our elevation. So I'll explain this with one metaphor that in the Old Testament, there is a story of the prodigal son.
Mm-hmm.
That there is this wealthy father who is like a landlord or a king, and one of his sons, the younger son, is very rebellious and wasteful. So he says, give me my inheritance. I just want to go. Father says, no, stay with me. What do you want to do? I want my inheritance. So he just leaves his father and goes away.
Mm-hmm.
And then he squanders all the inheritance. And when he loses all his money, he loses all his friends.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's begging, he's struggling to gain some food. So he works with a very exploitative landlord. And he gets, he is suffering. So when he is suffering in this way, so what happens? At that time, he, while struggling, finds some landlord who exploits him and doesn't give him anything.
Mm-hmm.
Any proper food or proper remuneration. Mm-hmm. So finally he decides, you know, I will go back to my father. Even if he takes me as a employee, you know, he treats his employees better than this person is treating me.
Mm-hmm.
And when he goes back, His father welcomes him with open arms. And his father says, oh, my son who was like lost to me has come back. And he celebrates. And this is seen as an indication of how loving God is.
Mm-hmm.
That the father is like God. And although we may reject God, God doesn't reject us. God welcomes us back.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an understanding of the loving nature of God. But in the Vedic tradition, God is seen to be much more than simply waiting. Oh, you come back, I'll welcome you.
Mm-hmm.
God works to get the person back. So how do we understand this? So that take the same example. So when the son goes away, the father doesn't just wait. The father sends his own representative. So this father is like a king.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, my son has left me. So, you know, the area where he is living, you know, you take the land over there. You become a landlord over there.
Mm-hmm.
Or you invite him back to your land.
Mm-hmm.
And you give him employment, give him place. And you are working for me. In that sense, what is happening? The son comes back to the kingdom of his father.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because the son and the father are not yet ready, the son is still estranged from the father.
Mm-hmm.
Son may not come back home. But the father is so concerned that the father wants the son to at least be in the kingdom. So in that sense, the devatas and Bhagawan. So Bhagawan is like the father, the king, the landlord, the big king, and the devatas are the assistants, the landlords who are working under the king.
Mm-hmm.
And they are all working for the same purpose, to get the lost son back. And so now that this landlord, he has got his property from the king. And because he has so much property, seeing that this lost son, this prodigal son develops faith, oh, maybe I should work for him, he will treat me well. So it's one common purpose. So, you know, this devata worship is a part of a majestic plan, and it is indicative of God's compassion. So God is not interested so much in his glorification, that you should worship me and praise me, as he's interested in our elevation. But okay, if you can't worship me, you worship my representative. You worship an assistant of mine by which you can get elevated. So the problem comes when we try to place our traditions, the Gita's teachings, within a terminology which is not adequately sophisticated. Then the idea of some narrow-mindedness and judgmentality comes in. But if you understand the compassionate mood of Bhagawan in the Vedic tradition, then we can also accommodate that.